people. It's all about the unity. There's nothing they can do with us, so ain't nobody.
We are in a state of emergency.
Prejudice. Wrote a song about it? Like to hear it? Here it go.
Free your mind.
I'm inspired by my brother, that Reality Temple's brother, the most powerful voice on the internet, that Real Angel Snubbing Up 7. That's right, brother. I'm calling you out, brother. I'm building you. I'm putting you out there, brother. I'm shouting you out. That's my inspiration.
Ellis becomes the first of the divas to offer the world her singular sound. And she does just that on Southern Gal.
Your mind. about Terry Act frowning like that with her album, guys' album cover?
She thinks she's cute.
That's all I got to say.
She croaks.
Terry thinks she's cute, huh?
Thanks, hon.
She came out with a different attitude after that.
She was like, I'm none to me.
That's old school. Life has changed.
I want the red. I want the red.
Wait, what was that Mr. T did in Rocky? What was that Rocky 3? Was it Rocky 3? Put the covers on my face!
There we go. I don't have a lot to say. Come to see Terry. That's Terry, Cindy, and Rona.
I trust that feeling. Does anybody have any questions of me before I get out of here? Let's see what you guys are saying. What's up, Soul Sister Rona? Hey, Talik. I'm the brother that did my Mike Jackson in Tunica, Mississippi. Hey, now. Hello to Terry. Respect. Bless up. Bless up. Bless up.
Come to see Terry. That's Terry, Cindy, and Rona. It's Terry.
It's important for the black youth especially to know that we did have a history and that we did great things and that we had great people, and those things were not in the history books when I was in school. And what I'd like to be doing 5 years from now is attempting to rewrite the history books so that they'll know that.
Everybody who is black and interested in black people, let us sit down and find out how we can get together in one direction against one enemy and accomplish this job overnight.
When soul singer and black activist Sam Cooke wrote the lyrics to his song, A Change Is Gonna Come, it was very direct and to the point. With some changes to it, the song was still digestible. In the year 2019, black folks continue to go through the change rather than direct the change. A community activist named Talik Ibn Rod has made an appeal similar to what Sam Cooke was asking for. A change. It's said that the meek shall inherit the earth. We ask when. When will the landlords give the meek a free lease? Mr. Ebenrod is humbly asking for the state of Mississippi. This is Dusty Basement Studios, and we approve of this message.
Peace forever and always.
I'm Soul Sister J.
I'm Soul Sister D. Okay, thank you for donating to my Uncle Talik. I appreciate it, and I know that my family appreciate it because he's been in our lives for years now. So, yeah. And I just want to say thank you because, yeah, I'm happy. Yeah, and we love you guys. Mwah.
Bye.
Bye.
Peace forever and always.
He's forever and always. He's forever and always.
We want to make sure that we're not just working to be first, but we're working to be right. A lot of times there are situations when things are just happening so fast. It's always important to be fast, but we always want to be right.
There we go. I don't have a lot to say. Come to see Terry. That's Terry. Cindy, what's wrong?
We can talk. I don't know why people don't like talking to me. I don't bite, I don't think. Terry Ellis will tell you I don't bite, you know. So, anyway. She's a lady.
Welcome to the Reality Temple on Earth. My name is Jeroen, and I would like to say that Angel Snub 7 isn't a racist at all. He's a good friend.
Yes, Brother Taylor, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, I am Minister John Cooper. I live in South Carolina, Columbia, South Carolina. And I was watching, someone had sent me a video, and I was watching it, and I think yours popped up on the sidebar. I never heard of you before. When you get time, give me a call if you can. I did a sermon and finally got a chance to do it at a church. I am a minister, but I'm not active in the pulpit. I'm deciding to speak basically, trying to teach and getting our people ready and those that will listen. And this minister allowed me to do a lesson this past Tuesday night. Basically, my wife said, "Man, you were saying the same thing this guy's saying now, John," and it just blew her mind. And I just thought to present to that congregation who we were, and, you know, we don't want to be black, and what is happening to America, it is falling, those kinds of things, and they were looking at me with their mouth hung open, and half of them probably couldn't receive it, half did. And I just want to commend you for your work that you're doing. And
I do want to say something right now. There is a YouTuber who has really got in my heart. and at his angel snub 7. He reminds me a lot of my father. My father died last year of a heart attack, and Angel Snubnub, I don't hate black men. Like I just mentioned, Angel Snubnub 7 has gotten my heart. He's like my teacher, a mentor to me. I love him.
My name is Deborah Kennedy. I live in Texas, and I listened to Talik's video regarding failure of prayer and God's so-called promises. I was just delighted. I thought it was just very insightful. And I commend you all for putting something out there like that, that we just lean too much on what we're told somebody else is looking out for us. And we have philosophies or teachings like that. And we're supposed to be developing that in ourselves. And I appreciate Talik's his powerful delivery. You don't need to call if you're busy, but I just want to pass that along. I'm very impressed. Thank you so much. You take care now. Peace and love.
Thank you, thank you, thank you for having me, brother. This is an honor. I've been watching you for at least a couple years now.
Yes, sir.
From the first time I got hip to your channel, I've been hooked ever since. I'm always looking out for new videos. I mean, when I first saw your channel, I said, oh, this is an ancestor that has most definitely returned. Yes. Most definitely. This is not a new ancestor. This is an old ancestor. you could hear, you could feel the ancestors through you. You know, most people probably say, what is he talking about?
Right.
They don't get it. You gotta be on that level.
My brother Angel Snubnub 7 at the Reality Temple. And to give props to him, because I listened to all of Angel Snubnub 7's videos, I think that he comes from a different angle. And there's a powerful message in a lot of the videos that he put out, and I try to catch all of them. I look at him as a free thinker and a person that's willing to challenge those of which he don't agree with or which he may think differently from, and I really respect him for that. He's challenged KNBS, and he has also challenged the black supremacy movement as well. And I have nothing against that, because that which cannot be challenged cannot stand and will not stand and will not survive the test of time. How many challenges we can withstand will determine how long we will be able to stand.
And my name is Myron. They call me Snippy. My name Myron Johnson. They call me Snippy. My cousin is Dr. Omar Johnson. I'm here to give y'all a message. Y'all better leave my cousin alone. That's what y'all better do. My cousin Umar doing good work for y'all. Y'all some stupid ass niggas, man. And y'all ain't giving the man no money. Y'all think because y'all gave my cousin a little money, y'all think y'all own him. Y'all don't own a motherfucker
down up in hell. And you don't realize it. You don't realize it that God has been in prison. The devil was able to imprison God. So right inside your own self, your God self has been in prison, and you have a false sense of self running rampant inside the temple. This is why you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
We have to bring Reality's temple here on earth. Reality's temple here on earth.
Yes, sir.
We have to realize the enemy is running rampant inside this temple.
Morals are just, you know, subjective. But when you have laws and things on paper that say, if you do this, we're going to punish you by incarcerating mm-hmm. you, and you mm-hmm. break them, and you're dumb enough to get caught, then you're just dumb.
All right. Shout out to Reality's Temple in the building. Well, just from us, I got to get him on here, man. You talk about somebody polarizing. Whoa. that brother is, I'll leave that alone. Shout out to the brother, though, Just.
But you, a lot of your video content to me was very informative. You know, the things you talked about had substance, man. And, I first really knew about you because of JT Rally 1, Real Nigga News, and you and him got into a conflict with each other. And when I did my website, you were the only brother. And let me stress that. Because when I did that website, blackcommune.net, and I did the video and I asked the black YouTube community, the so-called black YouTube community, to give me your videos. Because at the time, a lot of brothers were getting flagged and videos taken down. So I said, you know what? You can put your videos on my website so that the message can still be heard for all to hear. You know, something like, you know, a little I made that website for everyone. But you were the only one that gave me permission to use your videos. And I thought that was very honorable of you and really a testament to how much you cared about the black community.
Come on. Assemble the people, come on. We will not be defeated by witch doctors' illusions.
And that is Brother Talik from the Reality Temples on Earth channel. And if you get a chance to subscribe, please do subscribe to his channel. He's a good brother. You know, he's doing good work and he wants to do good constructive things. He has good information to provide. So please do check out his channel if you get a chance.
Emergency. Prejudice. Wrote a song about it? Like to hear it? Here it go. Free your mind.
Keep it real.
What, dear?
Because I keeps it real like that. I keeps it real.
Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started quickly. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started. Ride, ride, ride. Let's get this party started quickly.
I got a friend got busted in his house, in his bed, where him and his wife sleep with another woman. Fucking his wife walked inside the house, opened up the bedroom door, saw her man in her bed with another woman. Fucking she walked and said, ah! Man jumped up, saw his woman standing there. She ran down the hallway, chased his woman down the hallway, butt naked with a rock hard dick, talking about, I'm sorry. It sounded like a tragedy, right? No, it was like this. Baby, wait, ho, wait, baby, look. Oh, hold on, oh, wait, we got to talk. Baby, I am sorry. No, you're not sorry. I can't believe you did this to me. You have no respect for me or our house. Get the fuck out, don't you touch me. Don't you fucking touch me. Wait, baby, I'm sorry. Wait a second. No, you're not gonna, if you're sorry, you wouldn't have fucked her. And then you change the shit around, right, guys? Okay, wait a minute. Wait 1 second, goddammit. Yes, I fucked her, yes. Is that what you want me to say? I fucked her, right? I fucked her. We fucked, all right? You happy now? We fucked. Now let's talk about the word fuck for a minute. Because that's a very important word here. Fuck, yes we did. Fuck, yes we did. Fuck. I fucked her. I make love to you. And if you gonna let a fuck come between our love, there's something really wrong happening here, baby.
Well, you heard it. You heard it as a joke straight from the mind of Eddie Murphy. Nothing but jokes. But this is a very serious topic. This is very, and we should take this behavior very serious, because it's detrimental to us as an individual. It is detrimental to us as family. It is detrimental to us as society and as a nation. We laugh because many of us can relate to what Eddie Murphy is saying in this particular routine. However, this behavior that we never laugh, and it is no joke, because we have become pleasure seekers, and because we are selfish as individuals. We want what we want when we want it. And we care nothing about our wife, our boyfriends, our girlfriends, and so forth. We don't care about our children. And many of us, we even get a dog and we don't care about our dog or our cat. It's all about our personal happiness, even if it's at the expense of others, others whom you claim you love. We use the word love in vain. Matter of fact, love is a trick word. We use the word love so somebody can let their guard down so that they may be exploited, deceived, and manipulated. Used. I love you. a love lie. It's not true. This type of behavior has caused countless divorce, the broken family, abortion, sexually transmitted diseases. Why don't we laugh? We don't laugh. Let's make jokes and let's laugh at sexually transmitted diseases. I don't hear nobody laughing when they contract AIDS or herpes or gonorrhea. Suffice to say, the emotional turmoil, the people whose heart has been broken because they thought their husband really loved them, or their wife really loved them, or their children really loved them. And we ignore the ultimate consequence of this type of behavior, Mr. Eddie Murphy. It is no joke that on many occasions at the broad spectrum of this behavior, we find abuse and neglect. And of course, the ultimate sin due or created by this behavior is murder. You lied to me. You told me you loved me. And so I get a gun and blow your brains out. If I cannot have you, nobody else will. So in the routine that Eddie Murphy is talking about, I fucked her. It's nothing but a fuck. But I make love to you, baby. Is there really a difference? Our problem in this society is because of our childish mind. We think everything is funny. We think everything is a joke. That's why Eddie Murphy has been paid millions of dollars. This is why, may he rest in peace, AJ Johnson was paid thousands and millions of dollars for being funny. Make me laugh. You want to somebody to make you laugh the same way we treat children, because you want to see children happy, because you want to find a way to keep them occupied so they would be less a problem to deal with. So let's play with the children. Make the baby smile. Keep them in a good mood so you don't hear them crying, so they don't express temper tantrums and whatnot. But as an adult, we know that there should be law and order, but law and order with justice. And see, this is where religion and spirituality and a lot of these teachings and scholarship that we cling on to, they have failed, because they have law and order, but many of these laws is not fair. And these laws play favorites usually to the men. And what is so worst of all is that we have human beings. You act this way because you have no value for yourself. You have no integrity. You have no honesty. You suffer from low character and no discipline, because physically you are an adult, but mentally, or even said spiritually, you are still a child. Matter of fact, many of you out there in religion and spiritual land, you call yourselves children of God. After thousands and thousands of years, you would think somebody from among you have finally become an adult, but you never grow up. This is unnatural, because everything that we know of must mature. Everything must grow up become an adult, or as the Quran say, evolve and evolve until it reaches its maximum potential. So you have somebody like this personality, Kevin Samuels, that calls himself, because he makes some money, a high value man. The top priority for Kevin Samuels to be a high value man is he must have a certain amount of money every month, $50,000 every month. But you can still act like a hoe. You can still act childish. You have no honesty. You have no good content of character. You have no discipline. You can still act like a hoe and be considered high value. This is our problem. And so the Kevin Samuels high value man produces broken family. The Kevin Samuels high value man produces abortion. The Kevin Samuels is a high value man, and the money that he needs in order to become a high value man, he does not give value to. The money that Kevin Samuels depends upon is based upon the value another man puts on the money. So we have a bunch of men and we have women who are adults by default, physically, but mentally, we're children. So we go out here and we play games and we can laugh at Eddie Murphy because we're childish. And we begin to focus not on the things that are adult, on the seriousness of life. We focus like we are still in high school, teenagers. We still act like children. We still act like we are going through puberty. We still have a childlike mentality. And when we go through puberty, we notice changes in our body. We notice the pleasure that we get from our penis. We notice the pleasure that we get from our vagina. We notice ourselves coming into this state of maturity, puberty. So it is interesting when a man sees a woman naked. It's interesting when a woman sees a man naked for the first time, and as a male, you see a naked woman, a woman, a girl, and you say, I thought I saw a putty tat. And then you become married with children, and you've experienced fucking, and you finally decide to settle down with the woman that you want to be a virgin and clean, while you've been out on the streets acting like a damn hoe, and you want to settle down, but still you're childish in the mind, and you have grown ass men that have had and seen many women naked, seen many putty tats. You've done a lot of fucking in your life, and you still want to go to the strip club, and these men still want to see naked women climb up and down a pole. You still want to see human beings exploited in pornography. You want to see human beings exploited strip clubs. You want to see people exploited in the sex trafficking business. I was fucking her, but I'm making love to you. If you was making love, if you were in love, then you would not be fucking somebody else outside of the relationship that you made a promise and you made a vow or have an understanding with. You wouldn't have been doing that if you was making love. No, you was fucking her, and you was fucking your girlfriend, you was fucking your wife, you was fucking your boyfriend, you was fucking your husband. You're just fucking. You don't know what love is about. Like Tina Turner said, what love got to do with it? If you was in love, if it was about love, love causes us to respect our relationships. Love causes us to be true to our vows, our promises, our understandings that we have in relationship. Even those in so-called polygyny relationships, they don't love. It's a bunch of people who got together so they can have a good fuck. That's all it's about. Because they will go outside of their these vows, these promises, this understanding. If you was in love, then the top priority is my family and my wife, my husband. I would die for my children. I would die for my husband. I would die for my wife. I would die for my nation. I would die for my society. I'm an adult. So now, like the Bible said, when I was like a child, I spoke like a child. Now I'm an adult, so I have to put childish things away. The problem here is that we don't want to grow up. We want to continue to go through the puberty stage, and we want to continue to live the life of a child. So here we are as black people, soul brothers and sisters in this nation. We want to continue to act like a child, so we don't have a problem with living under the jurisdiction and the injustice and the unlawfulness and the evil of Caucasian people in this nation, because we don't want to grow up. We let somebody else run the house because we don't want to grow up and take responsibility for our family, for our children, for ourselves, our destiny. As an adult, we should be interested in either in this nation that we live as an equal, we are seen and treated as an equal. Otherwise, we must leave this house and build our own house. But when you are a child, you are dependent upon your parents. And the parents in this situation is the Caucasian people. In this situation is the racist Caucasian people of this nation. They are the parent. So you must wait for them to give you handout. You pretend like you're an adult. You are a false adult. You are a pretend adult. Because an adult in relationship, family is first. So I would die for family. And if I cannot be treated in this nation, then I would build a nation for my children, for my family, and create my own society. I would do that as an adult. And as an adult, you don't have time for fucking. It's love, because love makes you want to put your family, your people, in a better position in life and control your destiny as an adult. We know very clearly that those in this nation still live in the puberty phase of their development and will die as children. They say it all the time again in religion, I'm a child of God, and that's exactly how they act, like a child. Not like God, but as a child. So, in the United States, regardless of race, in the United States, regardless of race, you see adult people who are occupied with sport and play, basketball, football, tennis, and the list goes on and on. Adult people who are occupied with games, and you watch countless hours of TV and cable, satellite, whatever you want to call it, YouTube, Facebook, and you play hours and hours and hours. And if they're not doing that, these adults who only know fucking, they don't know nothing about making no damn love, because they're children. Teenagers fall in and out of love like it's nothing, and that's how we continue to behave. Teenagers really don't take nothing serious because they're immature. They are immature. And as we grow up, we continue to have that same type of puberistic, is that a word, puberistic behavior. We still live in puberty. You have grown men, you have grown women occupied by the Xbox. This Xbox is in all numerous households in the United States of America, because it's a game. And they play games hours and hours and hours. So nothing like the teenager takes nothing serious. Like the grade school child takes nothing serious. Don't have to. I leave that to the adults. The adults are those who are in power, the racist Caucasian people in this nation. And that's who we depend upon. So what kind of high value man does or can Kevin Samuels produce when his mind is still in the puberty stage? And what does a young man or a woman do during the puberty stage? They try to act grown. And that's when they have a conflict with their parents. That's when you march. That's when you protest. That's when you get upset because, like a child, you really don't know what to do because you're not an adult. You can't act on your own. So you have a tantrum and you get all loud with the parents. And that's what we do in this country, black people, because we're not adults. We don't know how to handle. We don't know how to come into our own, become grown, and act like adults. So teenagers coming into adulthood, they act like an adult. Act like an adult. So Kevin Samuels is trying to act like an adult, trying to copy the only man he has ever known, and that is the white man, the white people of this nation. So we're nothing but copy Europeans. We're nothing but copies of our parents who are not Africans, but they are Europeans. And I don't care how much black power you talk about. But this behavior is fucking. When we begin to learn how to make love, that's when our condition will change. Just keep it going.
Te llamo para que vaya a recoger la paellera. Y me acuesto el sub, ya para abrir el restaurante que era el arroz. Y me llama el cocinero. Risita, ¿qué? Ve por la paellera. Venga, que a las 2 de la tarde ya están aquí. Miren, bañador. En las chanclas. Todo despeinado porque no me dio tiempo nada de ponerme las chanclas y el bañador. Voy a la playa, había subido la marea. Eso. ¡Eso! ¡Había subido la mano y encontré una paella! ¡Eso! ¡Y la encontré! Porque estaba la paellera agarrada. Entremetí entre las piedras de Chipiona, de Faro. Y cuando entro en el restaurante me ve el cocinero con una paellera y adentro la vende paella. ¡Asómate! ¡Mira dónde llega el agua! ¡Llegaba el agua hasta el restaurante! ¡Había subido la marea! ¡Ay! ¡Eso! ¡Ay, qué hacemos! ¡Qué hacemos ahora! ¡Con los dos sacos de arroz! ¡Ay! ¡Llama para Sevilla! ¡Llama a Sevilla! ¡Que traigo paella!
You wanna make me angry? Then I wanna shut your big mouth. All you have to do is make a couple phone calls. And then we'll see if you're gonna be on YouTube running your damn mouth.
Hey, what you doing, Snuffleupagus? Nothing. Just chilling. I was just chilling. And like many of you, we have telephone, we have cell phones in our homes. And my cell phone began to ring. And it was a number that I was not familiar with. And so I did not answer the call to avoid robocalls and other undesirables I'm not interested in. So if you want to talk with me, then you will leave a voicemail or you will leave a text or you will send me an email. So not too long after this unfamiliar telephone number made its appearance, I began to receive texts. I'm not going to say right now who this person is supposed to be. I would just say or give a little bit, talk a little bit about the context of this or the content of this text. So I'm like, who are you? And they tell me who they are supposed to be. What is it that you want? I want to testify that what you say about the doo-doo lady is true, because years back I had the same experience. They say, I asked them, why do you want to do this? And they give me the reason. And so while we going back and forth with the text, I'm thinking to myself, here's a person, instead of using their connection in order to try to solve a conflict, they want to make the conflict worse. They want to keep it going. And they want to use me to help them hurt somebody that they have a problem with now, but not a few, but just a little time ago, they are skinning and grinning with the person. And now for some reason, they're angry and upset and want to come to me and use me, use us for their agenda. Wow. I'm supposed to be that stupid to fall for that. First of all, I don't need you. We don't need your testimony to do a damn thing. This conflict or this war has been going on for about a month, and it's slowly coming to the end. of which I am very happy. It should have never got started to begin with. It got started to begin with by false accusations by a woman who assumed or believed I'm guilty of talking about or having no empathy toward her trauma. And she refused to accept the fact or my words and call me a liar that I was not talking about her. And then a person on our platform took their side. A person I was good to for years, since 2018, took their side against me and began and well actually set me up. Let this woman use her channel that I was the inspiration in order for you to build. Let her use that channel, set me up to bash me. But I let it slide. But then a person of whom I have no control of hurt your feelings and now all of a sudden you just fall apart and you begin a war. Now, we have the right to self-defense. And that's all I'm interested in. This bald-headed boombox cartel member Arab, fake-ass African, Pan-African sewer rat, from the very day I met this piece of trash, he had a problem in how I talk about Pan-Africanism. And so he began calling us Sambos and coons and whatnot. We have the right to self-defense. If you can call me a coon and a Sambo, Uncle Tom and all these names, then we have the right to self-defense. We can call you a name right back. I am not Jesse Lee Peterson. I am not, I forgot what his name was. He was a popular preacher. Don't hear too much from him no more. But I'm not one of these guys you're going to call an Uncle Tom and a coon and a Sambo. And I'm not going to fight back. Dr. King let Malcolm X and others call him a coon and a Sambo and all like that. I'm not going to do that. What's good for the goose is good for the gander. You call me out of my name, I'm going to call you out of your name. I'm not talking about you as a person. I'm telling you your Jesus is bullshit. I'm telling you your Pan-Africanism is bullshit. Your Hebrew Israelite crap is bullshit. Your black Muslim crap is bullshit. I'm saying that your black church is bullshit. We calling all of you out on y'all bullshit. It's business. It's not personal. So you use the wisdom of your ideology. You use the wisdom of your belief system to defend yourself, but you can't do it. It cannot be defended because it's bullshit. I don't give a damn how angry Brother Bakari get. I don't give a damn how angry Guy Nollywood get or Brother Ben or Louis Farrakhan or Tariq Nasheed or the Black Authority or Sinai. I don't give a damn how angry and upset Brother Polite, Young Farrah. I don't give a damn Cynthia G. I don't give a damn Michi X and the list goes on and on. I don't give a damn how upset these people get. It's nothing personal. Your ideology, your belief is bullshit. It's simple as that. And so when I'm calling that, I'm not calling you a name. I am challenging your ideology. I am challenging your belief system. That's disrespectful. It is not disrespectful to question and call out the bullshit on an ideology, on a belief. I'm not talking about you and your dog Scruffy or your wife and your children. I'm calling Pan-Africanism out. I'm calling the Nation of Islam ideology out. Christianity out. Hebrew Israeliteism, whatever the hell that is, out. So we have a person here who wants to join the bashing of our poor, misguided lady. And see, for us, or for me, when it comes to our people, when it comes to soul brothers and sisters, we have the right to defend ourselves, and that's all I'm going to do. I'm not interested in overkill. When you back off, we'll back off, and I'll back off. Go on about your business, but I'm still going to talk about your Christianity, your Hebrew Israeliteism, your Jehovah Witness stuff, your Black Muslimism, your Pan-Africanism, whatever it is, I'm still going to talk about it. That's not going to change. Nothing personal. Your strategy, your belief is incompetent. It's not successful. It's thousands of you. You have not went to heaven. You don't have a black nation. After all these hundreds of years, this needs to be called out. This is not acceptable. This is not to be tolerated. Being a loser and just keep giving us feel-good rhetoric is no longer acceptable. So you have this person who wants to use me to get to somebody, think I'm stupid. Make your own channel, make your own damn videos, and you can talk about this lady or anything that you want to talk about, all you want to. You're not going to use me because I am about healing. I'm about building. I'm not about, unfortunately, we have to defend ourselves. And I am like the Jesus of the Bible. I turn the other cheek only to my own, not to my enemies. If it was somebody else outside of ourselves, they'll still be getting a damn whooping. No mercy, no compassion, no empathy. But when I see that my own is backing off, I'm not seeking overkill. It's time. There's nothing wrong with you going your way and I go my way. But again, I'm still going to talk about your garbage, your bullshit, which is Pan-Africanism, Nation of Islam, Black nationalism, blackity-black, blah, 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 religion, spirituality. It's all bullshit and it's garbage. I'm going to call it out. And a lot of y'all, if we was able to put you in a court, the majority of you ain't nothing but a bunch of hypocrites anyway. Because if you wasn't a hypocrite, we wouldn't be having this problem. Your acting and your behavior is outside of the teachings that you claim you believe in. So a bunch of these folks ain't nothing but frauds and scam artists, and they have an alternative agenda. They want followers. They want people to get on their slave plantation. And I'm not interested to get on your plantation, nor am I interested or will allow you to use me for your crap. We don't need your help to do anything. So that's all I had to say on that. Jot down your comments. Let's continue to talk if you want. Peace out. Yeah. And you want to include us in your losership. It's not gonna happen.
I wanna talk to you.
We win.
I wanna talk
and don't have to do
you.
Nothing at all. That's why you're upset. This great seat. Okay, alrighty then. Let's, before we get into this short commentary, we're always accused of never talking about positive things. So I just want to give a short, brief commentary within a short, brief commentary about a news story where this soul brother was getting married to a soul sister. And whenever we see love, we should think positive. We should wish the best in life for that married couple as love have brought them together. So congratulations to our brother and our sister taking the plunge, deciding to tie the knot and venture together in this life, as they say, in the vows. What are those vows? Oh, yeah, well, till death do us part, sickness and in health, and all that kind of stuff. But of course, as we know, something about marriage, it seems as though everything is really, really cool, but something about that marriage license messes with people, turns people. So in the United States, there's a lot of people getting married, and some people are getting married just for the show. I's married now. They want to get married for the show. But then when they are in the divorce court and have to fight over the assets and the children, all of it wasn't worth all that show. Now, what makes this particular thing or this marriage proposal or wedding, it's not a proposal, the brother and sister are actually getting married, is that not only is he asking the sister for her hand in marriage, wink, wink, Terry Ellis, wink, wink, but it seems as though his bride has two daughters from another relationship, and he's asking the sister for her hand in marriage, and he asks the daughters to step up also, and he asks the daughters, could I be your father? Could I adopt you and you become my daughters? And the young girls said yes, like their mother said yes to being proposed to. I think this is a very positive thing to speak about. And again, I don't know who this brother or sister was, but I wish them the best in life. Unfortunately for me, because of my individual experience, I would move with caution because those children, those daughters, are not yours. And when you have a conflict, I'm very sure one day they're going to tell you,
You're not my daddy. You're going to have to go through all that crap. And you're going to have to deal with their father if he's alive. And because of my terrible experience, I would avoid women with children. I would avoid that. But that's me because of my experience. My experience does not reflect on someone else. Where I failed or where things did not go good for me, it is possible. And it is possible because there are many people who are in these marriages and have adopted the children of other people and became a family, and they're doing just fine. But again, in America, it's over 70% divorce rate. And who knows how many of us been in relationships and just broken up, and we're not part of the statistics where we marry men with children or women with children. And because of conflict with your baby's daddy or your baby's mama, it tears the relationship apart. Suffice to say, our own greed, selfishness, low character, no empathy for others, and the list goes on and on. This is a very serious human problem. So here on the Reality's Tip on Earth, we strive to try to create, develop, evolve into better human beings, because a better human being will produce a better or more of a percentile of success in these type of things, marriage, friendships, and so forth. Now, that's positive. We want to talk about positive, but as you know, we love negative things. We're not really into positive things. If I made a video just on this story, very few views. Who gives a damn about a brother marrying some, he's a simp, and the list goes on. You know how negative we get. What I wanted to talk about real quick was this young Pharaoh, Tasha K interview. I did not watch the interview. I just heard about it. And one of the main things that I keep hearing is people tripping on young Pharaoh, telling the interviewer, Tasha K, that he was abducted by aliens. And so many people don't believe his story. He's a liar and laughing at young Pharaoh and whatnot. This is my thing. The majority of these people who is laughing at young Pharaoh, talking about he's doing drugs, of which could be the case, and or whatever. He's out of his mind. He's a liar. Most of these people are believers in God. Most of these people are believers in spirituality, but they don't believe young Pharaoh. They make mockery and they're laughing at young Pharaoh. But at the same time, these are the same idiots who believe when you die, matter of fact, you don't never die. You turn into conscious energy, energy that continues to think like a human being. You turn into some kind of energy and you float around the universe to the different realms and dimensions in the universe. We're not supposed to laugh at that. They believe in the third, the fifth, seventh dimension, an all black planet, planet Nubaran or whatever the hell it is. These people believe in zombies. They believe in the virgin birth.
They believe if you die for Islam or in the name of Allah, you will die and your reward would be 40 virgins from somewhere. I don't know where they come from, out the sky. I don't know. Sister Noble told me she woke up and some kind of reptile was in her room and it reached out and touched her and she could feel the scales and it scared her to death. We believe in life after death. Matter of fact, this is probably one of many lives we've already lived. In another life, I was Cleopatra. In another life, I was, even if you may, it don't make any difference whether you're male or female. In another life, you could be male or female, or you could be a goat, you could be a bear. In another life, these people have had many lives. And a lot of these lives are famous. It just so happened they was a king and they was a queen in these other lives. They never was a peasant. They never was poor. They wasn't a homosexual in another life. Everything, all their other lives, when they tell you about these other lives, always good. These people believe in devils and gremlins and spirits and spooks. They believe in these invisible gods. When you invite them to the live stream, they never show up. Never. These people believe I'm an African. And then when they get on a plane and go to Africa and they step on another continent, they feel the spirits of their ancestors who they never met, don't know nothing about. They can feel their ancestors through the ground. Now, they laugh and they doubt the story of young Pharaoh being abducted by aliens, but they can believe all this other stuff from the Bible and the Quran and whatnot, but they can't believe young Pharaoh. All of it is bull doo doo. You're a liar. Pharaoh is a liar. Your Quran is a damn lie. Your Bible is a lie. Your black spiritual scholarship is a lie. All of it is a lie. If you can't accept young Pharaoh being abducted by an alien, why should anybody accept your garbage? Your virgin births. And your conscious energy, and your reptiles, and your Anunnakis, and all this stuff. A lot of this crap. These spooky ass people believe we don't even know nothing about. You're not in a position, if you believe in God, if you believe in all this spiritual stuff, you're not in a position to laugh and make mockery of young Pharaoh, because that's his experience. You claim your crap is real. Young Pharaoh says his is real. I'm not spiritual. I don't believe in no Bible and gods and all like that. So I'm calling all of y'all a damn lie. And there's nothing that you can say to me, because you cannot point to the spirit, the spook. Everything about us here on this platform is about reality. We're not asking you to believe a damn thing except believe in yourself that you can change your condition, because a man put us in this condition, a man can take us out this condition, and the man that should want for us to get out of this condition should be you yourself. But you're too busy getting abducted by aliens, turning into conscious energy, waiting to die, waiting for reptiles, zombies to come out the ground. You're waiting for some invisible most high Yahweh, Yashera, Jesus, Allah, and all the 5,000 gods to come and do something for your happy ass. So the bottom line here is, if you laugh at young Pharaoh, you're not in a position to laugh at him, because all of y'all is full of doo-doo. All of you should be laughed at. Outdated, silly. You can't prove what you're talking about, and he can't either. That's it.
How was your shower?
Oh, I tell you, Brian, all the rumors about dropping the soap are true.
Really?
Oh, yeah, you can't hold on to that thing to save your life. Oh, I was slipping all over the place. Guys were laughing.
Hey, there's a guy who couldn't hold on to the soap.
Oh, that was classic.
Let's get to grilling. Pass me the ribs, baby! Absolutely.
Butterfly in the sky, I can go twice as high. Take a look, it's in a book, a reading rainbow.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the one God to whom all praise is due forever, the Lord of the worlds, we thank Allah for raising up in our midst a divine leader, teacher, and guide in the person of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And in his name, I come before you and greet us in the words of the Arabic language. We say, As-salamu alaykum. A disclaimer that I am not an expert on the teachings of Messenger Elijah Muhammad. A disclaimer, I only understand and comprehend what my examples was within this belief system and within the context of the books and the audio that has been left by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. It is amazing of how, even when we listen to the same words, such as the case of Bible and Quran, or even the teachings of Elijah Muhammad, we listen to the same words, we can read the same words, but we bring forth different and various interpretations or meanings of that audio or those written words. of which something is wrong. Because if I say I saw a cat, there should be no other interpretation. I saw a cat. But if all of us was on the street and all of us, I saw a cat, it is incredible how many various different versions of the exact same event that will come forth. So I'm here and I'm wondering and I'm looking at, and I haven't really checked out our brother Ben in a long time, but what brought me to his attention, or what brought him to my attention, was these thumbnails. And I saw him, well, this is one of the thumbnails right here. And I want to applaud Brother Ben X. All praise is due to Allah for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I want to applaud Brother Ben X for what seems to be success. Material things. And I wonder about this new interpretation of Elijah Muhammad teachings. This form of teaching, this form of behavior, I did not grow up with. And I was introduced to the teachings of Elijah Muhammad in the late 1960s, early 1970s. My relatives, being members of the Nation of Islam, when the Messenger of Allah actually was among us. And I did not see this type of behavior. You saw this type of behavior in entertainment, chasing the dollar, wanting swimming pools and mansions and whatnot. You want to be a sports star so that you can get you a good white woman, live in Beverly Hills and party. You did not see this type of behavior as expressed by Brother Ben, who is supposed to be a Muslim who should not be enticed or should not be impressed by material things, because the material things of this world should not impress someone who has made a connection to God, who is the creator of the universe. So we have Brother Ben here, and there's nothing wrong with showing off your success if that's what you feel is success. But to my knowledge, this is not an expression of the, this is not the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I believe if we reference Message to the Black Man in America, you will find, if you reference Message to the Black Man of America, and even though she's a nasty cow, big fat pig, Aaliyah Porkchop Muhammad, she is correct that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad did not teach his followers to be materialistic. If you read Message to the Black Man, I believe that's where you will find Elijah Muhammad taught his followers to live the frugal life. To live the frugal life. Clearly, Brother Ben X and success and how he is being taught the teachings of Elijah Muhammad, he is not living a frugal life. He wants to live the life of a rapper, of an entertainer. But then again, his example of the teachings of Elijah Muhammad is an entertainer, a wannabe entertainer, in the person of Louis Farrakhan, who drives around in limousines and he stays in fancy hotels and travels around the world, first class and so on and so on. Success, being close to Allah, is material things. Elijah Muhammad taught his followers to live a frugal life. You want what your brother, what you want for yourself. So I will only be successful when my brother be successful. When my brother is able to drive a fancy car and have swimming pools and whatnot, then I am successful. That is not the teachings of Elijah Muhammad. This is not the teachings of religion at all. Material things is not success. But that's what you see from Brother Ben. That's what he's teaching, and that's what makes him attractive to Brother Ben, because I want money. Brother Ben also, like Louis Farrakhan, he has not, to my knowledge, has really been that successful. He wants to be a rap star also. He wants to be part of this world, not the world as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, not according to the teachings, not according to the books that I've read, not according to the example that Elijah Muhammad gave and presented before the world when he was here. I was here. I was listening to Elijah Muhammad when he was here. I was watching the followers of Elijah Muhammad when he was here. Brother Ben X did not see the followers. He did not see the movement of the followers of Elijah Muhammad when he was here. There was nobody running around trying to be an entertainer. Elijah Muhammad taught his followers that you should not be an entertainer. Matter of fact, Louis Farrakhan told you himself that he was a violinist, he was a calypso singer, and in order to be part of the Nation of Islam, in order to be the national representative of the Nation of Islam, he had to give his desire to be a musician, an entertainer, had to give that up. In fact, Muhammad Ali was asked to give up boxing and become a minister. And of course, we know the story of that. Muhammad Ali refused to do that. And the Nation of Islam backed off him, gave him leeway. Matter of fact, Muhammad Ali was able to wear his hairstyle a little higher than the rest of the brothers. He was able to continue to be a boxer. Well, we sometimes we sell ourselves out, because Muhammad Ali was a good tool for the Nation of Islam, and they gave him special privileges that the other FOI could not have. So we have Brother Ben here, his desire. He bought this new Corvette car. I want for my brother what I want for myself. And we know that a Corvette car like this, and it looks like it's brand new. And we know that the money, the resources that you use in order to buy something to show off with, because that's what it is, we show off. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught his followers, buy a car to get to point A to point B. Who you showing off in front of? But this is how they are attracting the youth. This is how they are attracting. They want to show to you, if you become a follower, if you believe this religion, look what you can get. You can get your brand new car. You can get you some cash. This is what they use to entice the youth. I want to be a part of that. That's success. In success, they see the preacher running around in his long cars. They see money, and they see the women, and they see all these things, which is success. Mind you, that the Nation of Islam does not build Corvettes. So all their money, all their cars, all their chains that they wear around their neck, everything about them Look at the Benjamin Franklin. Everything is about the white man. Even Brother Ben's Master Farad Muhammad God is a white man. Looks like a white man. A white image of God. Everything about them is Caucasian. That's why I tell you, everything about the so-called American Negro is white. I don't care how black they talk. I don't care how Hebrew Israelite they are. I don't care how Kemetic or Pan-African. All of these are white people. They act like white people. Their idea of life, living, is like white people. Everything about them is Caucasian. Everything about them is European because that's all they know. They copy other people. They have no uniqueness to themselves. They want to try to keep up with the Joneses. They want to be something they never been. They want to be. So success is material things for them. In order for them to get respect, it's material things that somebody else create. They did not create the car. They don't bring value to the money. They own nothing. They control nothing. And their idea of success is trying to be like somebody else, trying to be like Caucasian people. That's a damn shame. Well, y'all keep following that. Has it been really successful? No. You're successful, and you can brag about the little things that you get, but it's millions of these folks, and look at the condition of the people that follow them. Chasing the dollar. Chasing the money. But at the same time, they claim, I'm chasing God. I'm spiritual. I'm on a higher level. You're on a higher level, but you need to drive a Corvette to get there. A Corvette that somebody else, your enemy that you call a devil, they are the ones producing it. You're unable to do that. It makes you wonder. It makes you wonder. But again, it's the same old religious hypocrisy, you know, same time, different channel. We wish Brother Ben the best of luck because he's going to need it.
I'm so Sister D.
And I just wanted to say thank you for all the people who helped to the medical fundraiser for my Uncle Tamik. And it has meant so much to us that you would help, because without you guys, his life would not be possible and we would not be with him today right now. And I just wanted to say, for all of you that helped and that donated, I would really like to give a big thanks, and I hope that I can meet you one day and say thank you in person. I love you guys. Amen.
Bye. He's forever and always. Everybody, Drake. Please say no, but I'm just gonna throw it out here. Escape, they did the reality show, TLC, had their biopic, plus their show for Is You the Girl or whatever. They were looking for another member for the group. Would you guys ever do reality TV?
Never say never.
I want to say this.
How are you doing?
What? I want to say this. It's not that we have not been approached multiple times to do reality television, but really, honestly, it would have to be on our terms, because we don't see ourselves fitting into the typical reality TV, I don't want to say box, but really box.
And let me add this. Oh, go ahead.
Go
I'm
on.
Sorry.
No.
I just want to add that if we were approached with the right opportunity, being black women as we are, if we are in control of our narrative and we are able
You're
to...
You're not in the editing room. They're going to edit you crazy. Your man's going to have to be on the show.
Hear me out. Because it is a platform, but if we are able to be responsible on this platform...
You're better than that.
...to uplift, elevate,
Okay, encourage.
Inspire.
And inspire. I ain't finished. Okay. All women, but especially black women, because we are black women. And there's a lot that's going on that hasn't been addressed that needs to be addressed.
I think that you do all that uplifting and stuff through the lyrics in your music. I just don't want to see you on reality TV because it tears people up.
If is the operative word, if, because
and you got the most to lose with a husband and kids.
Oh, yes, trust, I know.
That's why we have to control our narrative.
But that's also why you haven't seen us do a reality show yet,
exactly.
Because it's not that we have not been approached. It's just that we have certain standards that we'd like to stick to, and if we can't, then we have to say no.
Right. So much fun. I do love En Vogue. They're going to stick around and perform a medley of their songs. So keep it here. Back to sing a medley of their hit songs featuring their new single, Rocket. Give it up one more time for En Vogue.
Hello. When I come around, you say I got to go. My friends never called line two before, and I don't know nobody named Tyrone. Oh, now it's Thursday. You left the house to go to work an hour early. Said you had some papers for your boss to sign, but you left your briefcase home. And when I called your job, they said you were not there. Oh, yeah. Went to bed and said that your head aches. Now it's a weekend, and you know that it's the day I do my cleaning. And when I washed your shirts, I just could not believe. And here we bought your sleeve, stuck a letter in your pocket from
So the day has arrived that many have been waiting for, and that is the day of the verdict of this poor man. And I say poor because in reality, he also is a victim, but unfortunately, just because you yourself was a victim, and then you turn around and become the perpetrator of a crime against others, your own personal victimization, nobody really want to hear it. They don't care. Because of your actions, the hurt, the pain, the humiliation that you have brought to others. So today, a verdict was reached in the R. Kelly sex trafficking trial in New York. And he has been found guilty. And for many, this verdict brings us joy. For myself, I'm looking at it from a judgmental point of view. As being a judge or being on that jury, you take a high responsibility to hear both sides of a story so that you can determine the fate of one who is on trial. The quality of the juror determines the outcome. The quality of the evidence and the information, the quality of the defense, the quality of the prosecutor determines a lot of times the outcome of the trial and the fate of those or one who is accused of a crime or a misdeed. I must applaud anyone who has sat on a jury, regardless whether they got the verdict right or wrong. It is a great responsibility to know that your vote determined whether a murderer is set free or you have made the right choice and you have sent someone who have been accused of heinous crimes to prison or even death. There is many times problems in the jury pool because we are human beings and many of us, we cannot be biased. No, we are biased and we are prejudiced and we are racist. And we are misogynists. We are, what's that word? People that do not like transgenders and homosexuals and gays. What's that word? I forgot what it's called. So you have all these things in the jury pool. And these things, because we are human beings, it affects the outcome of the verdict that will be handed down against one who is accused. I was told that we're supposed to be judged by a panel of our peers. Well, if that's the case, technically, none of these people on the jury was R. Kelly's peers. Technically, men who were guilty or men who were accused of a sex crime, who were singers in entertainment, technically, I know I'm over exaggerating, I'm cutting it close, right? But technically, those will be his peers. Those in the jury pool are not his peers. They cannot relate. They've never been in this situation. And since if R. Kelly had those who were like himself in the jury pool, I can guarantee you chances are the verdict probably would have turned out different. But as black people, as soul brothers and sisters in this nation, we know and we have never, very rare, that we've had an opportunity to be judged by those similar like ourselves. So, of course, as you know, in the past, all white juries acquit outright guilty white offenders. We also know why we jump up and down and some of us are happy about R. Kelly being found guilty. We know that R. Kelly could not be a sex trafficker all by himself. R. Kelly clearly had a lot of help. And I don't know if any of these others who we know helped have been identified, nor do we know they would be charged. He had an accessory. There's another word that I would like to, that I can't think of right now at the time, but somebody who helped R. Kelly do what he is accused of and found guilty of. I know what that word is. I can't think of it to save my mind. Anyway, moving on. I'm saying this also. These accessories in the crime could be friends, could be family, and they know these people around R. Kelly knew what he was doing, and they knew what was wrong, and they participated. And some of our friends, some of our family, some of our associates, they know and be around people who are wrong in judgment or involved in crime, and you help them. You see it on YouTube. You help people be wrong. You help people in their error. Friends, family, associates. We help people we like. You have people like Tariq Nasheed. You have people like Louis Farrakhan. You have Young Pharaoh. You have Sarnetta. You have, the list goes on, all these people that we like, including Angel Snuff Nub 7. Because I am capable of error. I am capable of being wrong. And you do me, and we do our friends and these people we like a disservice when we help them, help us in our error, help us in our wrong. So it is a possibility, had R. Kelly truly been around friends and real family, and people stood up, even if it meant I can't get the money, or he would fire me, or some reward, it's better that I bring this to his attention, rather than now I'm looking at my brother going to prison for the rest of his life. Then we have those who are self-righteous. They're self-righteous. Always looking to judge people. They don't do nothing wrong. Angel Snuff Nub 7 is wrong. R. Kelly is wrong. Michael Jackson is wrong. Donald Trump is wrong. Everybody's wrong except them. Nothing wrong with them. Self-righteous people. And we help them in their self-righteousness because we believe in their wrong. We believe in their error. And so we go along with them. And all of you are damn wrong. And you are in denial. And when people bring it to your attention, you don't want to hear it. Just like R. Kelly didn't want to hear it. No criminal wants to hear it. Nobody accused of a crime and guilty wants to hear it. Because in their mind, Adolf Hitler didn't want to hear it. In the mind of Adolf Hitler, in the mind of Charles Manson, in the mind of serial killers, many of them justify, many of them view themselves as in the right, like we do. In our self-righteousness. So you judge based upon your religion. You judge based on your ideology upon others. And you can be wrong, but you don't want to hear it. you are in denial of your wrong, of your own error. And you don't want to be judged, but you're quick to judge others. So Angel Snuff Nub 7 is a mental patient. But you can judge, but you don't want to be judged. Angel Snuff Nub 7 is a mental patient. But then we point out your flaw, your error. And you don't want to hear it, and you cry. And the world is against you in your self-righteousness. Oh, pitiful you. But you can judge. Nothing wrong with you. But you can easily see the flaw. Everybody hurt you, but you don't hurt nobody. All your words is kind and beautiful. And everybody else tell you things that hurt your feelings. You can dish it out. We can dish it out, but we can't take it. We can judge others, but we can't handle being judged. We don't understand our own flaws. We don't understand our own error. We don't understand when we are wrong. Well, contrary to popular belief, I understand that I can be wrong. I understand that I can be in error. I can understand that I can be in flaw. But also at the same time, we all have the right to defend ourselves against false accusations. But we should be honest with ourselves. We should be honest with ourselves to determine if those who are judging us, are they judging us out of evil intent, or are they just truly speaking their mind and they could be right? This is what it's called, honest critique. Man, I'm losing a whole lot of words. I guess I don't use them a lot, so they disappear. Honest critique. Nobody trying to hurt you, but I feel this, I feel that. And we become defensive because we're self-righteous. I don't do nothing wrong. How dare you bring that to me? I don't do nothing wrong. That's you. I read my Bible. I read my Quran. I'm a Pan-African. I'm a black Muslim. I'm a Hebrew Israelite. I don't do nothing wrong. I am in tune with the Most High. And you wonder why we cannot progress as an individual. We cannot progress as a people because we are in denial of our incompetency. We are in denial of our wrong, our being in error. We do ourselves a disservice when we just ignore even negative commentary, because that negative commentary might be true. But again, that's because we're so emotional over things and we're not willing to listen because in our self-righteousness, I don't do, only other people do messed up stuff. Ain't nothing wrong with me. And that's the attitude you find on YouTube. Ain't nothing wrong. You never hear these people talk about their error or their flaw because they're perfect. They don't do nothing wrong. Somebody always doing something to them. They don't never do wrong. They're never in error. They don't hurt people's feelings. They don't scam people. They don't use people. Everything they do is right. But if we took the time, and if poor R. Kelly had taken the time before he took the road to the abyss of no return, maybe he would have had an opportunity to see that this is a road I don't want to go down. It's better to go down the road and enjoy the gifts that my talent have caused me to have. We do ourselves a disservice when we believe we're perfect and we are holy and righteous when we're not. I have learned over the years, and even though people are nasty, they're trying to hurt your feelings, they're trying to belittle and make mock of you, a lot of times there is truth in what they say. So instead of being emotional, let me look at this and see if there's any truth in it. And sometimes, even though the person is trying to hurt you, sometimes it's truth in what they say. And so I listen, I understand my error, I understand my flaw. Instead of judging others, being in denial and pointing fingers, making excuses for flaw, making excuses for my error, blaming others, let me try to be better. So let me work on what somebody has told me, because I can't see everything. I really don't know everything about myself. Maybe I cannot see myself. So maybe even though this person is trying to hurt me, they see something that I cannot see. I take it into consideration. I don't like it. I don't believe it. But let me work on this just in case it's true, and you become a better person. You become a stronger person. And instead, woo, man. So instead of being self-righteous, making yourself right, others will see you in your right. And they have no choice but to determine and come to the conclusion and judge you as being righteous. They have no choice. Whether they recognize and tell you or not, you've become better. Instead of living this self-righteous lie, ain't nothing wrong with me. The society is wrong. The world is wrong. My dog Spot is wrong. Ain't nothing wrong with me. So now this poor young man is in a position where now it's over. He has no options, and it seems as though he may spend the rest of his life in prison. And we judged him. We may not be in a physical prison, but as long as we continue to live and not try to be better as a human being, we also are locked up in prison. We're also behind bars. Let us think about it. Jot down your comments. And let's talk.
This is it. Shoe Show is celebrating 50 years in business with a huge warehouse sale this weekend and this weekend only. Save big on all of the top brands that you and your family want to wear. Nike, Skechers, Reebok, Timberland, New Balance, and more. All of the top brands, all of the popular styles, and over 60,000 pairs to choose from. So listen, if you wear shoes, then you must be at the Shoe Show Warehouse Sale this weekend. Take I-85 to exit 55 and then follow the signs and go online at shoeshow.com.
I'm the Shoe Show Warehouse Sale
this weekend only.
I hate you, Shoe Show. I hate you, Shoe Show. I should do. I'm gonna get in my car and make a bad video about Shoe Show.
Well, lady, maybe the whole problem is you. You
jazz. I want that. Oh, I need that. Gots to have that. It's
how many times, how many times, how many times. And folks get angry at me because they live in La La Land, fantasy, fiction. They want credit for things they did not earn. How many times have I said I feel great embarrassment. I am ashamed of my gender. I am ashamed of the incompetence. I am ashamed of the cowardice. I am ashamed of the ignorance. I am ashamed of a group of men who want to be called men, who want to be called fathers, but they have done nothing since they've been so-called free to show. In fact, they behave like full functioning men. I met a truck driver, a brother, a few years ago, and he was actually bragging and boasting, talking about his only mission in life is to get a baby in every state of the union. So he wants, his ultimate goal is to try to get a child, one in every state that he ever drove in. And he drives the continental 48 states of the United States of America. Of course, as we know, or as we may believe, truck drivers make decent money. But there's no way this man, on a truck driver's salary, can support 48 babies. There's no way. But that's the only way he can feel like a man, is by making babies and bragging about his penis. That's it. So I'm watching Paternity Court with Lauren Lake. There's another man who has 12 children. 12. The big one, too. But he's bragging about his so-called father, which in reality, within the soul or black community, the reality is there are no fathers. There are no men. I said none. And they don't like it. Well, that's a personal problem, because that's the reality of things. That's the reality of our lives in this country. We've done this male gender, soul brothers, African-American males, whatever you want to call, have done nothing to earn the right to call yourself a man. None. So this man who has 12 children is bragging and boasting about his sperm donor father who had 32. The big 3-2. This is the only way the black male gender, they have no other accomplishments. They can show nothing else except playing with their penis, finding gullible women, and making babies that they cannot support. They do nothing for, offer nothing to, provide nothing, protect them from nothing. So we have slavery. these men would be Adolf, descendants of slaves here in America, the United States of America. So as long as the black man was a slave, you cannot expect a slave to be a father. The only thing a slave can do is be a sperm donor. He has no choice. He's the property of somebody else. So, according to our history, this black man was set loose. He was not set free. He was set loose. And he entered another stage of life called sharecropping, which is nothing but slavery, and they give you a few dollars. And under slavery, it was normal that we have a lot of children, plus we was Christians, and all children is a blessing, according to Christianity. But these children became nothing but slaves for their parents, working on the plantation, working on the farm as sharecroppers. They became farmhands. Whether the male actually loved his children or not, that's up for grabs. We got a lot of work to do. We were running a farm. There was no birth control, so the women just spitting out babies like rabbits. So, now, we are 100 years, a little over 100 years, off the slave plantation. These men want to claim, I'm a man, I'm a father. But they provide nothing. They make no laws. They are not equal to the men of this nation. Now, if they were equal, I would not be having this conversation. But we all know there is no equality. So these so-called fathers, these so-called men who fought and died for this country, it don't make any difference. One of the best citizens ever, don't make any difference. They make no laws, they make no policy. They control no resources. They're nothing but a big consumer. Incompetent leaders, and all they give to us is feel-good rhetoric. Pretty speeches, telling us to keep the faith. They give us nothing of substance. And we accept this from these losers, these so-called fathers, these so-called men. That's acceptable. That shows you how insane we are as a people, that this is acceptable. Nothing is acceptable to give you nothing. These men bring these children to a hostile environment, racist environment, and give the children no kind of skills, give the babies no kind of warning that you are in a fire, that you've been born into hell. You let the children believe that this is normal and everything is going to be all right. You don't give a damn. Selfish-ass men, selfish-ass women bring babies into the world knowing this is a hostile environment, and you don't do a damn thing for them. And we supposed to praise Happy Father's Day, Happy Mother's Day. What the hell did you do as a father or a mother putting your child in a dangerous situation? You are a father, but you produce no baby milk for your children. The mother does not breastfeed. The mother doesn't even love her child enough to breastfeed. Matter of fact, a lot of women view breastfeeding as nasty, even though they don't mind having a man with 32 teeth in his mouth suck on their breast. It's nasty for their baby to get their sustenance off their breast. You give your child Similac, this father, this black man, don't produce baby diapers or baby car seats, have no schools, offer your children no man or womanhood training because you don't know what a man is, you don't know what a woman is. The only thing you ever been in your history is a damn slave. You just freshly come off the slave plantation. Your idea of being a man and a woman is copying white folks and other people. This father, this man, has no culture. He wants to be an African. He wants to be an Aboriginal. He wants to copy other men from other places, foreigners. He has no culture. He has no identity. He makes excuses for his reckless sexual behavior by using religion, be fruitful and multiply. But at the time, there was no people. We have about 5 billion people on the earth. There's no need to be fruitful and multiply. And the resources that we depend on is dwindling, becoming polluted, and cancerous. I'm having all these babies to secure my legacy. What kind of legacy? You don't have an identity. You suffer from identity confusion. And your legacy is just what I described. You don't produce anything. You're a pitiful, weak gender. What kind of legacy? You want somebody to hand down your legacy. Your weakness. You're pathetic. You're a bunch of losers. Your vanity. Nature does not care about your pathetic vanity. You want to feel like a man. Nature, there's no DNA for Johnson or Muhammad or Rodriguez or whatever you want to call yourself. Your DNA, your legacy, your family name. DNA don't give a damn about your family name. Nature only cares about the survival of a species. That's vanity to make you feel like you're a man. And the sad thing about it is, after a certain period of time, the future generations don't give a damn about you. You will be forgotten. Your legacy don't mean a damn thing. Nobody's going to even talk about your dead ass. And the reality is, your legacy is the white man's legacy. Because that's all you know. And you can scream black power, and you can be a Hebrew Israelite or a black Muslim. You can do all that. Your legacy is white folks. And that's what you pass down. And that's what we see. Because you have failed to provide. You have failed to protect. You have failed to produce your own culture. You have failed to produce your own identity. What kind of damn legacy you going to hand down to children? So having babies playing with your penis makes these guys feel good. That's the only way they can feel like a man. Because they have not done nothing that shows they are full-functioning men. So I say on this platform, because either you're going to be a man or you're not. I say none. There are no men. There are no fathers in our community. When you earn that, when it's credible and valid, then you should get the credit. The little ding-dong, the little ding-a-ling, the little twiddle-twaddle crap that my gender does don't impress nobody. It does not impress white men. It does not produce Mexicans. It does not impress the Asians or anybody or Africans or nobody. We're cowards. We're incompetent. We have no power. We have no respect from nobody. So we make these babies and we control these silly women who have never really known a man. And so through them, they make us feel like we men. But the reality, when compared to other men in America, especially the Caucasian men in this country, don't even come close. So we run around here and get a little money. We pretend men, fake men. I say they don't exist. keep playing with your penis, making babies. In the name of my ancestors, peace forever and always, and welcome to another edition of what we call the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. I am the gatekeeper or the host of this program, known here on social media. Wherever you may find me, I am known. Shh. I am known as the Mighty One, the Mighty, the Mighty, the Mighty, Angel Snup Nup 7. I am your soul brother, number one. Many of you familiar with the struggle, the history of the American once called Negro, you already know, or if you are in study, you will learn that during our history or within this struggle, it has been brought to our attention that we have natural leadership that is birthed from our womb, because it is natural for us to fight for justice. It's natural for us not to want to be a slave. It is natural for a person to fight against oppression and what is harmful to their life. So a leader doesn't have to be chosen from the people. From the womb of a woman, within that, people who are suffering, a baby will be born by nature who has the attributes of rebellion against an oppressor or a civilization or society that this child was born from. And it seems as though they actually were born to fight this fight. And they bring skills that make such a make such thinking credible or valid. These for the oppressor, these for the evildoer, those who come up in this manner, such people are very, very dangerous and a threat because their very being, since it's their nature, it is what they were born. People like this cannot be bought. And the only thing on the mind of people like this is the ultimate goal, the ultimate vision of seeing the people they were raised from, the people they were birthed from, that they come out of and beat this horrid condition once and for all. This is why it was necessary to murder someone like Malcolm X, because he was not interested in the material things of this world. He was not interested in nothing except the liberation of his people. This is what made Dr. King a threat. He was not interested in material things. He was interested in bringing benefits, doing whatever it took. And he had a vision and had plans. He had a strategy by nature in order to try to uplift his people out of this oppressive condition. So they had to be murdered. And if you notice, they didn't try to be leaders. Malcolm X was not trying to be a leader. Dr. King was not trying to be a leader, but their leadership potential, the people recognized. And that's why so many was attractive to these men, because they saw the answer to the problem that they were suffering in these individuals. But at the same time, you had those of whom we call sellouts. They were not raised. They might have been influenced. They might have been under Malcolm X. They might have been under Elijah Muhammad. They might have been under Marcus Garvey. They might have been under Dr. King. They might have been their students. They might have been influenced. But they were not born for the struggle. And the oppressor, the enemy, could see their flaw, that they were interested in the material things and they could be bought. So they were like when the devil took Jesus to the mountaintop and the devil told Jesus, look what I can give you. If you denounce that God, if you denounce your father, if you denounce what your father is offering you, look what I give you. And so the oppressor takes many of these persons to the mountain. I know that in the beginning, you probably did believe in the struggle and you probably did want to do what was right for your people, but they ain't going nowhere. They are a lost cause. You're wasting your time. Enjoy yourself. You can use them to better your life. Look what I can give you. So you have two types of leadership. You have those who were born for the struggle by nature. And then you have those who are made and those who are put on a platform by your oppressor, by your enemy, to distract you, to mislead you, to keep you locked up in confusion. Now, when I first came to YouTube, before Google, YouTube basically was an even playing field. There was no AdSense money. The best you could do if you wanted a little fame, you know, a little praise, you could get that. There was no money involved when I first came to YouTube. And you had those who would get thousands of views. But at the same time, Angel Snuppin' Up 7, I was right there hanging with the best. Of course, because of my unorthodox views, I don't expect to get, I'm not teaching religion. I'm not teaching spirituality. I'm not talking about entertainment. I'm not talking about sports and play. I'm not talking about all these things that the American once called Negro, what we love to hear and talk about. So I don't expect to, for thousands of which they did. I mean, I had 5, 6, 10,000. I might have 50, 60,000 subscribers right now had it not been for Google continue to take down my channels, because there are people, whether you like it or not, there are people who are interested in what Angel Snuppin' Up 7 has to say. There are people who respect the wisdom and what comes from this platform, whether you like it or not. So, in 2021, you think that Angel Snuppin' Up 7 is some little fella that nobody gives a damn about. But people like Sarnetta, the Black Authority, Tariq Nasheed, and a lot of them, because I was here before them. They heard my name somewhere. I was in the mix somewhere. I had a back and forth with this Jason Black guy back in the day. He knows who I am. Sarnetta knows who I am. Tariq Nasheed knows who I am. A lot of these people know who the hell I am. The difference between them and me is that I am made by nature, and they are made by Google. And so they sell you out. They have no vision. They have no plan. They have no strategy. They have no integrity. They have sold you out, keeping you back and forth beefing, giving you feel-good rhetoric, telling you about the problem, but clearly they cannot solve the problem. Google is keeping Angel Snuppin' Up 7 from being able to criticize and challenge them. When I make a video putting their names in the title, those videos should get thousands and thousands of views. Google is promoting them. Google is pushing me to the side as much as possible, because I am the threat. I am the natural leader. I don't care nothing about the material things of this world. I am like Malcolm. I am like Dr. King. I am the natural. These are supported by Google because Google made them, Google paid them. And if you notice, all of them are getting AdSense money. All of them are getting paid. You cannot get AdSense money unless unless advertisers find your message acceptable. Advertisers are not going to find the message of Angel Snuppin' Up 7 acceptable, because I am anti-religion, anti-spirituality, anti all this blackity black stuff, anti all this feel-good garbage. And Angel Snuppin' Up 7 is the real. And they don't want to promote the real. So they will promote Sarnetta. They will support the Black Authority, Cynthia G, Taz the Exclusive, Lennon Honor, and the list goes. They support all these people because they are not a threat to the powers that be. That's why. And they protect these people from those like myself who challenge them. Here you have all these people, and we can go back to 2010. These people have thousands and thousands of listeners and followers, and they have not produced anything. And please put the Nation of Islam, Louis Farrakhan, in the mix. Put all of them together since 2010, and I think Farrakhan was promoting Justice or Else or whatever. Well, put all that Justice or Else, put all this stuff, Tariq Nasheed, Yvette Carnell, Ados, put all this stuff together since 2010. They have produced nothing. They have progressed. They have done, accomplished nothing. And that's what Google loves about them. Put you in a position so that you can't accomplish nothing. They have no vision. They have no strategy. They have no goal. They have no plan. You just wandering in the desert, looking for water you will never find. And that's, you're thirsty, and your leadership, these people who you have taken as leaders, lead you nowhere. And they don't want me, my voice out there, to criticize them, to waken your mind up so you can see that these people are rose to nowhere. I am the natural. These are the people who sold you out, including that faceless troll, Alquan, the sellout.
I love these padded seats.
No! No, my head is stuck!
Put it out!
No,
put it out!
Correct them, please! Please come off! Please come off, man! How did something like that happen? Oh, my... Oh, Norman! Norman! Chef, please give me a towel! Please!
It's the spot.
No! No!
I wanna talk to you. I wanna talk to you. Just breathe.
So you have a lot of people out here that actually want to worship Satan. I want Satan to be my dad. Satan is the God. And when you really look at it, Satan really is the way to go. He's the better between the two. We really should be spoiled. But this father, this God, got a serious mental problem. Hateful. You twin, you gonna do what I say. Right? I'm gonna punish you for 400 years. I'm gonna rape you. I'm gonna let these people cut your baby out the womb and smash his head into the ground. Cause you did not obey me. Wow, what kind of parent is that? want to let Adolf Hitler put you in a gas oven. And lynch you. This is what this God, this Father does. Because you didn't obey my commandments. Bah, bah. See, that's not my story. The deacon says God was a child molester. That's what happened.
Everybody who is black and interested in black people, let us sit down and find out how we can get together in one direction against one enemy and accomplish this job overnight.
When soul singer and black activist Sam Cooke wrote the lyrics to his song, A Change Is Gonna Come, it was very direct and to the point. With some changes to it, the song was still digestible. In the year 2019, black folks continue to go through the change rather than direct the change. A community activist named Talik Ibn Rod has made an appeal similar to what Sam Cooke was asking for. A change. It's said that the meek shall inherit the earth. We ask when. When will the landlords give the meek a free lease? Mr. Ebenrod is humbly asking for the state of Mississippi. This is Dusty Basement Studios, and we approve of this message.
You and I live in an identity crisis. Who am I? I'm Angel Snuff Number 7, the Mighty One, here on social media. And welcome to another edition of what I call the Realities Come on Earth within the ministry. And I am also your soul brother, number one. I don't want to keep you long. I just want to make a quick point, and we want to be out of here. I know some of y'all got some weed to smoke. You got some sex to get. You got some barbecue. You got all these different things.
Sister D.
And I just wanted to say thank you for all the people who helped
to the medical fundraiser from my uncle Tariq. And it has meant so much to us that you would help, because without you guys, his life would not be possible and we would not be with him today right now. And I just want to say, for all of you that helped and that donated, I would really like to give a big thanks. And I hope that I can meet you one day and say thank you in person. I love you guys. And next.
Bye. Bye. He's forever and always. He's forever and always. He's forever and always. Hmm? Everybody join.
Yes. I want that. Oh, I need that. Got to have that. It's
everybody who is black and interested in black people, let us sit down and find out how we can get together in one direction against one enemy and accomplish this job overnight.
When soul singer and black activist Sam Cooke wrote the lyrics to his song, A Change Is Gonna Come, it was very direct and to the point. With some changes to it, the song was still digestible. In the year 2019, black folks continue to go through the change rather than direct the change. A community activist named Tariq Ibn Rad has made an appeal similar to what Sam Cooke was asking for. A change. It's said that the meek shall inherit the earth. We ask when. When will the landlords give the meek a free lease? Mr. Ebenrod is humbly asking for the state of Mississippi.
This is Dusty Basement Studios, and we approve of this message. Thank you.